Hack your brain and remember everything with Obsidian. What a marvelous promise. I wouldn't have dreamed of it and I wasn't even looking for it. All I wanted was to take digital notes for eternity. That was one of my concerns when I started browsing for a more suitable software for my research and writings than, say, Microsoft Word, which I was using since teenage years out of sheer habit. Then in 2020, I went searching. I tried a few old and new note-taking tools, such as Evernote and OneNote, but also Rome Research, Athens, Notion, until I finally settled with an app that not only is perfect for note-taking, journaling, and writing in general, but to virtually remember everything. And this app is called Obsidian. Hi friends, my name is David and this is another video of me explaining note-taking things. The script to this video is available in my public vault, it's linked below. As I already described at length in my video about knowledge-based basics, I capture and organize my life and my everything in Obsidian. It's a free software that is great for people who take a lot of notes, do journaling, creative writing, or for students of philosophy, for example, or other text-heavy subjects. And also for everyone who still goes to school and wants to store their notes from the get-go in a digital, useful way. Today I want to highlight some of the key features that made me choose Obsidian over the many competitors for my second brain, because that's what it is for me by now. The first half of this will be information on the app, the second half will be about the installation and implementation of Obsidian. I will talk about what an Obsidian vault is and what to consider when creating one. If you are still on the lookout for a second brain, hopefully at the end of this video, you will not only be convinced that Obsidian might be a good choice, but you will be all set to start using the app. However, this video is not about how to actually use Obsidian yet. For that, I will recommend a great follow-up video so you can dive right in. That being said, if you have any questions about Obsidian, note-taking, journaling, second brain stuff, feel free to leave a comment below. And best of all, subscribe to this channel so you don't miss out. But for now, let's roll. To get to know Obsidian and download it, we go to Obsidian's official website, obsidian.md. There we first read the sentence, "Sharpen your thinking." This is currently the slogan of Obsidian. It fits well for a note-taking app because notes are basically thoughts recorded in writing. By creating your notes in Obsidian in such a way that they are linked to each other, and are repeatedly edited and thus sharpened, you literally sharpen your thoughts. So that's what Obsidian wants to be good for, a note-taking app that lets you capture and process your notes, thoughts, in such a way that you can engage with them more intensely and thereby learn to think more clearly. That is, sharpen your thinking. In this context, the new logo of Obsidian, revealed in June 2023, also fits quite well. Obsidian is not just an app, but first and foremost, of course, a stone. And very early on, people realized that this stone can be used as an excellent tool. More about this again in my video about knowledge-based basics. The Obsidian logo now shows such an Obsidian stone in the form of a kind of hand axe, a primitive tool, or rather, the very first tool humans had for cutting things up. That's just what we do when we sharpen our notes, gain clarity of our thoughts, and finally make better decisions. The word decision comes from the same root as scissors. By deciding on one thing, we cut off something else, other choices, so to speak. So that's another thing Obsidian wants to be good for, a note-taking app that helps you think more clearly and make better decisions. A high ambition, but I think this app lives up to it. That's because the team behind Obsidian focuses on the right things. But before getting to these, speaking of the team, Obsidian is not open source. Usually I favor open source, I prefer Bitwarden as a password manager, I like WordPress as a CMS, and I might have considered the open source Obsidian alternative Logseq as a note-taking app. The reason that didn't happen is quite simply because I fell in love with Obsidian first. And secondly, to me, the key features of Obsidian make up for the fact that it is not open source. And thirdly, the Logseq logo really didn't pick me up. I know it's silly, but I gotta be honest here. Anyway, back to Obsidian focusing on the right things. Here are three of those things spotlighted. First, your thoughts are yours. Obsidian stores notes on your device so you can access them quickly, even offline. No one else can read them, not even us. That's great. However, you have to make sure that your files are safe from someone else's access on your device. If you share a laptop with family members, for example, make sure that you have your own user account that only you can access. Only then will your thoughts really be yours. Second, your mind is unique. With hundreds of plugins and themes, you can shape Obsidian to fit your way of thinking. This is genuinely awesome, but of course also a double-edged sword or a double-edged hand axe. Especially in the beginning, it seems daunting and complicated to have so many options. It's important to know that you can use Obsidian without any manually added plugins and themes just fine and get to know all these additional functions step by step and according to your own needs. Still, if you use Obsidian for a while, you will quickly notice through the many plugins and thus the possibility to implement virtually everything in Obsidian somehow, this app becomes all the more powerful and valuable. Third, your knowledge should last. Obsidian uses open, non-proprietary files so you are never locked in and you can preserve your data for the long term. This is absolutely critical. All the talk of smart and systematic note-taking wouldn't do any good if it resulted in notes that would be unusable with the next update of the app or worse, the disappearance of the app. I want my notes set up in a way so I can still access them in 10 or 20 years. To make that possible, Obsidian works with non-proprietary files. Proprietary means owned by someone, tied to a vendor. A Word file, for example, is tied to Microsoft. A non-proprietary file format, on the other hand, is publicly and freely available and not controlled by any company. When Obsidian emphasizes working with such a file format, in Obsidian's case the Markdown format, it means that files created and managed in Obsidian can also be opened in a variety of other applications, not just Obsidian. This prevents vendor lock-in, a situation where a customer is dependent on a vendor for certain products or services and cannot easily switch without significant cost or inconvenience. This shall not be the case with Obsidian, which is what makes the files created and managed in Obsidian so long-lasting. For this, by the way, a reading tip, Kepano's blog post on the topic File Over App. If these three highlights don't convince you yet, you can look further on the website and discover some more powerful features like links, the graph view, the use of canvases for mind maps and more. For starters, it's also interesting to take a look at the pricing of Obsidian. Obsidian is free for personal use and is promised to stay that way forever. I think that's important because as far as personal notes go, I wouldn't want them behind a paywall. If you want to use Obsidian for commercial use, then you should purchase a license for commercial use. This costs $50 per user per year. What is meant by commercial use is explained in the FAQ. It says, commercial use licenses are required whenever Obsidian is being used for work for a business with two or more personnel. Sole proprietorships or other one-person organizations do not require a commercial use license. Work for educational purposes does also not require a commercial use license. That's pretty generous of Obsidian. But then, what does the app do to earn money? As mentioned, Obsidian is not open source. There is a team behind it which can be checked out right here under About. Currently, 7 humble humans and 1 fluffy feline. So back to pricing. Obsidian earns money in a few different ways. One is through paid features or add-ons, Obsidian Sync and Obsidian Publish. Sync is used to synchronize one's notes across different devices. Now, because Obsidian is based on local files, you can also do this in other ways, for example via Dropbox and Google Drive. Obsidian Sync makes it more comfortable, but if you use one of the mentioned cloud services anyway, you can sync Obsidian without additional costs. For more on that, see my video on how to sync Obsidian for free. What's also very convenient is to make part of one's notes or text publicly available, if needed, with a website that can be managed directly via Obsidian if you use Obsidian Publish. I use both add-ons and I think they are worth every penny. Another source of revenue for Obsidian are the Catalyst licenses. You get such a license via a one-time payment of $25 or more, according to your liking. What you get in return is early access to new features and a supporter badge in the community on Discord, for example. This is voluntary, you can do it, you can leave it. If you hang out in the community, you get an impression of how many people like to support this app financially. And if you use Obsidian for a while and realize what a powerful tool you can use for free, then you get the urge to give something back at some point. The Catalyst license is a good way to do that. So this is a short overview of what Obsidian offers. If you want to try Obsidian yourself, you can download the app by going to download. It is available for pretty much every platform, in my case Mac, but also for Windows, Linux, and mobile systems. Once you have installed the app and open it for the first time, you will see this window. If you want, you can change the language here, be it to German, Italian, Polish, there are quite a few options. At the top, for those who have little time or are eager to explore, there is a quick start button to jump in right away. But for now, we'll focus on the three options in the middle. You might notice that there's one term coming up in all of these options, and that's the vault. You can create a new vault, open a folder as a vault, or open a vault from Obsidian Sync. But what is a vault anyway? The term describes many things, one of them being an arched masonry structure supporting the ceiling of a chapel, for example. It also stands for a secure room within a bank or any archive of past content. Each of these meanings fits with what an Obsidian vault wants to be or can be, namely a place where we collect personal things that are important to us, maybe even sacred to us. One's thoughts, memories, texts, perhaps entire works of writing, research material, references, notes on contacts, diary entries, and much more. However, it's also important to understand that an Obsidian vault is actually nothing more than a digital folder on your device. So really nothing special, a simple local folder. By default, not even an encrypted one. So creating a new vault basically means creating a new folder. As you can read in the second option, you can also open an existing folder as a vault. This, mind you, only works with folders that have a certain content, namely folders with Markdown files. This is, as mentioned, what Obsidian is based on. So just opening a folder with Word documents wouldn't get us very far. In general, if you are just starting with Obsidian, you can ignore the second and third options here. Instead, you want to create a new vault. So let's click on Create. Next, it says create local vault. This again underlines that you don't create a folder in any cloud on foreign servers, but on your local device, your notebook or whatever you are using. There are two things to do here. First, you have to choose a name for your awesome vault. That is, name the folder you want to create. You can always change the name later, so you don't have to worry too much about that. But because an Obsidian vault can and will be more than just a folder to you in the long run, namely a treasure trove or the supporting structure of your digital mind palace, so to speak, you might also want to assign a name that's more meaningful to you. If you're looking for some inspiration, below this video you will find a list of possible vault names. But as I said, you can always change it later. Still, the vault name will also show up in Obsidian afterwards. So if you call it Vault 1 or ASDFG, you'll have to know for yourself if seeing that name all the time might bug you. Of course, because there is a plugin for virtually everything, you can also install a plugin to hide the vault name in the Obsidian view. But that takes us too far already, I just wanted to mention it. I'll call this vault Daedalus. As storage location, we can now choose some place on our device. Even this choice is not so important because you can move the folder later, no problem. For example, I go to my user folder there in the default documents folder, create a folder there called Obsidian, and choose that as the location for my Obsidian vault. Great. If you want to use Obsidian Sync, you should not put your Obsidian Vault in a cloud folder like Dropbox or Google Drive, because then you can have problems when two different services try to sync files at the same time. So if you use Obsidian Sync, create the folder outside of such clouds. However, if you don't want to use Obsidian Sync, but you do want to sync your files between different devices, then your cloud as a storage location is just the right choice. However you do it, please also note, syncing is not the same as creating a backup. Having Obsidian store all your files and notes on your device comes with benefits, but it also comes with the responsibility of backing up those files yourself. If you store all your notes, texts, maybe diary entries from several years in your Obsidian vault, and suddenly your device breaks and you can't get to your folder anymore, that can be very, very troublesome and a situation where the Obsidian team can't help you. There are many ways to do backups on the Mac, for example, with Time Machine. Cloud services like Dropbox and Google Drive offer backup options, and there are also Obsidian plugins to make backups, such as Obsidian Git. Without getting further into detail here, I just wanted to point it out so you remember from the get-go, make sure you have a backup of your Obsidian Vault, this brand new folder on your device, so you don't lose it if the device ever stops working. That's about it. Now we can press Create. A folder will then be created, as you might expect, in the location where we've chosen with the name we've given it. And this folder, or vault, is also immediately opened in Obsidian. Here's a first look at the user interface of Obsidian, out of the box. There's a lot to see and explore right away, but that's another topic for another time. If you want to begin exploring yourself, you might start by creating a new file and your first Obsidian note, where you can write something down. This was meant as a first introduction to Obsidian. For a far more elaborate deep dive into Obsidian, I highly recommend the video about remembering everything with Obsidian by No Boilerplate. It's linked below and gives an absolutely fantastic overview for all of you who want to learn more. If you have any questions or feedback so far, as I said, feel free to post in the comments. Thank you for your attention, and I'll catch you on the flip side. Bye.